Hey, good evening. And being that it is Erev Rosh Chodesh Adar, which is Hebrew translated into the day before the new moon of Adar, so I wish you all a very healthy and pleasant and joyful and wholesome new month. Jewish calendar is a lunar one, so just as the new moon is renewed every month, So too, our lives are renewed, like the moon is, and this is why one of the reasons when we make a blessing on the new moon, you know, once a month, we go outside and we actually look at the moon and make a blessing on it. And one of the prayers that we say is Shehem Asidin Lischadish Kamesai, the day, referring to the people and the souls, should be renewed as you are. So the moon is a symbol of renewal, whereas the sun may be a symbol of consistency and intensity and continuity. The moon is continuously in cycles, waxing and waning to the naked eye on earth as it goes through its phases. And therefore, it really reflected much more of the changes in our lives as opposed to the continuity and the consistency of the sun. And changes, of course, also mean birth and all the cycles that we go through, which obviously means that the moon is much more reflective of real life than the sun is. So though the sun has its messages, the moon, primary message, is one of renewal. But that can only happen as the old dies, the new is born. So every month has its own energy and its own renewal. And the month of Adar, as the Talmud tells us, Mishanichnas Adar Marbim Besimcha. When we enter the month of Adar, we increase in joy. So even though all renewal has the nature of joy, when you feel renewal, reinvigorated, rejuvenated, so it always feels that should be a cause of joy in a person's life. Yet there are months where it's not as blatant. And the month of Adar, it is actually a month that is considered a month of joy. It's associated usually with Purim, the holiday of Purim during that month, the 15th, the 14th, 15th of the month. The new moon will be tomorrow, the next day. The full moon, however, is always the 15th day of the Hebrew calendar, and that's why the most major holidays, Jewish holidays, are on the full moon. Purim is on the 14th and 15th of Adar. A month later will be the full moon of Nisan, will be Passover. And Sukkot is on the full moon of Tishrei. And the same with many other months. Not all holidays, obviously. The full moon, Rosh Hashanah, which is renewal itself, New Year, is the new moon. It's the first day of the month. Sukkot, which is the full moon. So the full moon of this month will be Purim, and like the full moon of Sukkot, which is also a joyful holiday. So being that that's the energy in the air, joy and happiness and gladness and cheerfulness, and all the other synonyms that come with being happy, it seems quite appropriate to speak about this elusive theme called happiness. You know, people talk about being happy. They want to be happy. They could be happy. The different ways to become happy. So we all know that it's much more complicated than it sounds, especially as we grow into adults, finding a happy life, a life that is fulfilling, and one where you have inner contentment, a cheerful disposition, so on, is not so easy to achieve. And there are obviously many questions about the topic itself. Many books and theories have been posited about the nature of happiness and joy. And of course, the first question always has to be asked whether it's something that is predisposed, meaning predestined. Some people may be just born happier than others. You know, and therefore it's like a genetic thing. And it's not really in our control, which of course is a very fatalistic approach, because then there's nothing to really look forward to. You know, you are what you are, and just like you can't change your stripes, your colors, your spots, you can't change perhaps this element of our personality. Obviously, the question itself leads us to understand, especially from a Torah point of view, which is antithetical to fatalism, is that it's not that way at all. but it's still important to analyze. Because we look around and you see two people looking, having the same set of circumstances, both facing a challenge or a difficult situation, and one person is able to maintain an equilibrium and their composure and maintain a certain positive sense and optimism, an optimistic outlook, and another person, the same conditions, or maybe even easier conditions, and has a very negative attitude. And it's easy to shake them, and it's easy for a person to fall into being despondent or other sensations or feelings that are opposite of being happy. And of course, we all understand as well that happiness, being a happy person, when you're in a happy state of mind, when the day is going well, that itself becomes the root of many good things. Whereas a person who's, I don't know what the exact opposite of happiness is or gladness, whether it's sadness or depression or pessimism, however you define it. But clearly when a person is happy, their whole spirit is lighter and buoyant, and you're more of in a place where you can solve problems easier. When you're weighed down by sadness or by anything that is causing you anxiety or fear or worries, clearly, it also limits it. It compromises your tools. You know, when you want to make decisions, you want to be clear-headed. A person who's happy and is of lighter spirit has less burdening them, and therefore more focus to be able to focus on something and be able to make a decision. So it becomes a vicious cycle, where a lack of happiness in turn gives you more difficulties, less tools to be able to resolve your issues, which in turn will make even less happy. So it becomes like it can spiral completely out of control. Whereas if you're able to turn on a switch called happiness, if there was such a thing, then clearly that itself would be an opening to helping resolve many issues. So just this fact that we have a pleasant attitude to things, someone who has a happy attitude and just that type of positive outlook at things, that doesn't mean their problems are solved. It just means that they're much more empowered and they are more in a position to make clear decisions and be able to navigate. And of course, the opposite of that would be someone who feels weighed down, feels overwhelmed, feels unable and disempowered, and unable to really make a decision, make a move. So you have in the Torah, even beyond the month of Adar, you know, before I proceed, since I have some opening questions, I was going to say it at the end of the class, but I also say at the beginning of the class that this class is dedicated by a good friend, Alan, in honor of Furu Shlema for Rivka Bat Leah. So may this class and the teachings that we discuss here, and hopefully the happiness and joy and upbeat outlook of life that everyone's going to leave with, right? Are we sure about that? Are we guaranteed? I can't guarantee it, but that's what we're shooting for. That anything that we do achieve in this coming together this evening, may it merit her and finding her refuah shleima and opening up her channels of happiness and joy. So, you look in the Torah, and the Torah I refer to as a blueprint for life. So when you study it, you find profound, relevant psychological insight into the human psyche. And it talks about joy, and talks about it actually in a way that is somewhat, you could say, surprising. The Torah actually has a commandment that one has to serve God with joy. Ivdus Hashem b'simcha is an expression, to serve with joy, simcha. So the word in Hebrew is simcha. There are another places that says there's the verse in the book of Deuteronomy, Tachas ha-shle'avad Hashem l'kecha b'simcha v'tuv le'vav. It speaks in the negative, because you have not served with the expression of simcha, joy, and tuv levav, which really means, literally tuv levav means gladness of heart, or means a good heart. And from this we derive, the mitzvah of serving with joy. But it's also, sometimes the Torah says do something, and sometimes it says don't do the opposite. Like it'll say, love your fellow, and there's another verse that will say don't hate anyone. So often the Torah has a positive and negative about the same idea. And it was called a mitzvah sesa, a positive commandment, and a negative one. Actually, the word commandment is also a misnomer, is not a really accurate definition. Mitzvah really means connection. And avera, the opposite of a mitzvah, does not mean sin, it means disconnection. So think of it, positive connections and negative connections, disconnections. And in that sense, so there you have both statements. So clearly, the Torah is suggesting, not just suggesting, stating outright that one is told to be joyful. That means it's in your choice. And that means it's not, the Torah cannot command someone, for example, to have blue eyes, or to be taller than they are, or to change the shape of their bodies or something like that. I'm talking about the things that are in our control. So as soon as there's a command, or there's a connection, or there's a obligation, that clearly suggests that it's in our control. Which in itself is a very powerful message, because sometimes in the world in which we live, we don't even know what we're in control of or what we're not in control of. You know, there are definitely messages constantly inundating us from many different directions, even from youngest childhood, that we're not really in control of many things in our lives. It's all been predestined, either due to your wiring or due to your id, in Freudian terminology, or due to the nature of the species of survival of the fittest. You're selfish and narcissistic. It's because that's the nature of all creatures on earth. I mean, there are those that scientists and thinkers that actually state that outright. So maybe it makes some people feel better about themselves. That way, you know, you don't feel so guilty the next time you're narcissistic. But it definitely doesn't create expectations, you know. And if you really think about it, if we are evolved creatures from the wild, so just like we would not prosecute or criticize a predator hunting for prey, and as sad as it looks that the gentle or tender creature is in a very vicious way mauled and killed for food, why do we see, when we human beings behave that way, why do we see ourselves different if we're just creatures? What's the explanation why we prosecute and see it as a criminal and crime for us to hurt each other? So you know the classic story, Lucy comes home from school, and she's studying biology, the origin of our species, and she's confused, of course, so she asks her father, I'm sorry, let's start with the mother. She asks her mother, you know, where do we come from? Where do we originate from? So her mother, beaming with pride, says to her, well, I'm proud to tell you that grandpa came from a little city in Poland, grandmother from a city in Switzerland, in Czechoslovakia. And go back a few generations back, we had a grandfather that was a great rabbi. Before that, someone who was an author and compiled a classic Torah work. And before that, we go all the way back to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Sarah, Rivka, Rachel, and Leah. Okay, that's very nice. Now, when her father comes home, Lucy asks her father the same question. And he says, sit down, embrace yourself. You know, he was waiting for the day that he would have to share this with her. And don't be shocked, but we originate firstly from apes. And prior to that, amphibians, these are water creatures. And prior to that, bacteria. And as far back as we can figure out, several billion years, a ball of gas. So you can imagine that Lucy's quite even more confused now that she's gotten these two answers from her mother and her father, which weren't exactly consistent. So she goes back to her mother and says, what's going on? You know, you told me this. Dad told me that. Her mother says, listen, it's both true. Your father was telling you about his side of the family, and I was telling you about my side of the family, you know. So there you go. The final resolution to the battle between creationism and evolution, it really comes down to which side of the family you're talking about. That way we resolve it, reconcile between the two of them. No more battles, okay? You teach both. This is not just a nice anecdote. It also really is about how we see ourselves. Are we humans that with a soul, created in the divine image, as the Torah says, and therefore expectations of us are to be divine, and there's nothing that is not expected of a human being to be? It means our potential is unlimited, just like God's potential is unlimited. Or are we creatures and animals in the wild that just have evolved and now walk on two instead of on four, and we have bigger brains and we have figured out how to think in abstraction and to build civilization, build to not dominate all of nature, including all those creatures that we evolved from. And I'm not getting into a debate here about the issue. Everybody could do what they wish with this. But I'm talking more on the moral and the personal level. How do you see yourself? When you look in the mirror, what do you see? And of course, the answer is that there's two parts in us. And that's what the Torah also says. There's the nefesh habamis, there's the animal soul. It's actually an expression, animal soul. And there's nefesh alakiz, there's a divine soul. And when you look in the beginning of the Torah, it's actually the story. Adam and Eve, what does it say? That God said, I want to create a human being in my image. And God took earth from the ground, dust from the earth, and infused it, imbued within it a soul. He breathed. It says divine breath. You know, neshama in Hebrew, which is soul, also comes from the Hebrew word neshima. It could be pronounced neshima, which is breath, which explains why so many spiritual exercises are connected with breath. Because breath and soul are really synonymous. Our human breath is an expression of life. And the balance of breath, exhaling and inhaling, is the expression that, as the Kabbalists put it, based on a verse in Ezekiel, that there's rotze v'shuv, which means tension and resolution, exhale and inhale, the same thing our heartbeat, contraction and expansion, and the same thing as God breathes life into existence, into earth, into the dust of the earth, which is the human being. So you're made up of two parts. There's the dust part of us. You can call that, you know, the Adam, which comes from the word Adam, comes from the word Adama, which means earth. And then there's the other part, which is the divine soul. Now, interesting, when I say Adam, I'm not talking about the male, I'm talking about the human being, male and female. And then the woman is called Chava, actually, because she's called the mother of life. So there you go. A man is called earth, and the woman is called mother of life. You tell me whether the Torah is feminist or not. So you have here these two forces within us, and are not just two forces, but they also have two voices that impact our life every moment. Every moment. And in every choice we make, we either act like the animal, which is more for our own needs, survival, or the human, the divine, which is reaching upward and looking to improve the world around us. Basically, one is a taker, one is a giver. One is a survivor, and one is transcendent. I mean, many other ways to describe it. But the point I'm leading up to is that the Torah expects an unbelievable amount of from each one of us. And that's not meant to put a guilt trip on us. On the contrary, it's a gift. It means you're truly capable of. And I submit here that I believe that most of our choices and how we look in life, it very much begins with what you think you're capable of. If you think you're not capable of much, you clearly are not going to shoot for the stars. And that has a direct impact of what the people around us, especially in our formative years, our children, our parents, educators, and society expects of us. And this is very different from one home to the next, from one community to the next. But overall, I could say, as I've discussed many times here, we are inundated with messages that do not have great expectations of us. And especially in a commodity-driven world, which I will soon elaborate upon, buy this and you become happy. Purchase this, acquire this, and you become fulfilled. Which in sense says that if you don't have it, you're not that fulfilled. And when you see other people getting it, that makes it even more miserable if you don't have it. So once you already have defined certain things as being necessary, so-called, for your wholesome life, that means as soon as you're deprived of them, you're not going to be as happy. So on the other hand, when the Torah demands expects of us an unbelievable amount, far beyond anything that we're sold or we're told, and that you have it all within you. You don't need to purchase anything because you have it all inside of you. So you can say that a person's expectations are in a way, when you hire your expectations of everything that you need to get in your life, you usually will not find too much happiness. When you realize how much can be expected of you because you have so much potential, as we'll soon discuss, that's the formula. So the first thing that the Torah says is that, yes, you're expected to be a happy person, which means it's in your choice. You're not doomed, and no one controls your life. It doesn't matter what circumstances, this commandment, this obligation is universal across the board for every human being on earth. It doesn't say happiness only for those that have had happy experiences, or only of those that have not suffered, that have not had any tragedy or trauma. There's no such statement. It's a universal statement. And it's actually a gift. It's telling us what we're capable of. So interestingly, when someone asks of you something and believes in you, that itself tells you that there's a vote of confidence that you're capable of it. And according to the Torah's assumption, which is that God created the human being and the soul, so God clearly can tell you what your soul is capable of. He's telling you your soul is capable of reaching heaven and beyond. And no matter what your life is like, you can be a really happy person. Just knowing that is already a critical component, because as I said, if you don't believe in yourself and you don't believe in your potential, that alone is your biggest impediment in growth. And you'll see this with every coach and anyone who is really successful in motivating others. The key to success, the first key, is that you have to have the person believe in themselves. Some even think that can even be, if they hype it up to the point that you may not even have that potential. The fact that if someone believes in you, that you can end up doing things that you really were not capable of. But the truth is that, from a Torah point of view, we're capable of far, far more than you expect. Now, and that itself is a battle, because we're constantly getting messages the other way around. Besides the fact that we get overt messages from many people in our lives that we're worthless, or close to that, and don't think you can do so much, who do you think you are, and all that type of stuff, there's also subtle messages that we get. And very much the definition of marketing, a product to you, and making sure that you feel you must have it, does not contribute to happiness. It contributes to you always feeling deprived if you don't have it. And then the question is, how much can you acquire in this life anyway? Can you purchase every advertisement that you see? Is it possible? So the more we expose to, in a way, the freedoms of our lives, and the prosperity of our lives, the affluence, the options, even though on one hand are definitely a reflection of freedom, but also a reflection of you never being able to ever satisfy yourself. So how could that create a content human being? So in addressing this issue of joy, you know, of course, how could you obligate someone to be joyful when they're just not? They're not in the mood. You know, you can obligate somebody to do something even if they're not in the mood. You know, give charity even though you're not in the mood. An action can be regulated, but an emotion can be regulated. How can you command someone, tell someone, that you have to be joyful? And what happens if Purim comes and that day happens to be a miserable day in your life? So what are you supposed to do? What switch are you supposed to turn on? Which of course begs the real question, is what is joy? And how do we define it? And a similar question is asked by the Maggid of Mizrich about love. There are two commandments, love God and love your fellow. And he asks a similar question. How can you regulate love? You can say, be kind to everyone. So even if you don't love the person, you have to be kind, you have to be menschlich, you have to be cordial. But love is a commandment. Love, ahavta, is the expression. How can you regulate a feeling? Maybe you just don't feel love, that's it. What are you supposed to do? So his answer, the Maggid's answer, is that the mitzvah is on the meditation. That if you really meditate about a person's qualities and virtues, primarily about their soul, you can love every human being. This doesn't mean love necessarily in the romantic sense. It means that you can find something to love. And if you look with very material eyes and look at the surface and project your own insecurities, obviously you're not going to love others. Which really brings us to a bigger question, which the Maggid does not address, which is, if you don't love yourself, can you love another person? If you loathe yourself, if you have low self-esteem, how can you really look at somebody else and really find love to see? How will you see it in them? I mean, I don't mean in a childish way where you say, you know, I hate myself, but I love everyone else around me. I mean it more in a context of, can you really have feeling for someone if you don't have a feeling for yourself? You can. What's your point of reference? If you have no self-respect, can you respect another? So all this is, of course, addressed in the same question about joy. How do we define happiness, gladness of heart? Simcha v'tuv levav, we say. Simcha and tuv levav. Literally, joy and gladness of heart, or goodness of heart. Tuv, a good heart, a glad heart, a happy heart. So, I've discussed this theme once, more than once, several times in this class. I just want to sum up a few points, but really go to something more practical, which is what we can do about it. So there's the philosophical side to this, and there's the psychological side. As we all know, there are many ideas we can appreciate and understand. That doesn't mean you can implement. There are many things that we all would agree upon, but then tomorrow morning or tonight, to try to execute it and do it, it doesn't go that easily. Why? Because emotions tend to cloud our judgment and tend to cloud our ability to make a move. I mean, how many times in your life, it's probably countless times, where your mind told you clearly this is a wrong thing to do, and you end up doing it anyway. It's not because you're insane, it's because the mind and emotions are two different tools. And when your emotions get a hold of you, a passion seduces you, or anything that takes control of your emotions, your mind can be telling you at the moment that it's not good, and there are risks, and that it can be dangerous, and could actually be severe consequences. But the moment that you get consumed or obsessed with something, your mind ceases to have an effect on you, even though you may understand. And how often have we shared with somebody else? You can explain to them something is wrong, and still they'll act. And as a matter of fact, even after the consequences and the same situation comes up again, people may do it again. And it's not just because they're risk takers, it's because emotions distort. Hashechid ya'aver enech hachamim, the Torah says, bias. Shechid is bias, bribery. This blinds the eyes of the wise, and misalif divrei tzaddikim, and it twists the words, the tongue of the righteous. So the Torah declares that they are chachamim and tzaddikim. It doesn't say the tipshim, the fools. It says wise people, because no matter how wise a person is, nobody is immune from bias. In the Tanya, the way the book of Tanya, Rav Shneur Zalman of Liadi puts it, very, very poignant way, in chapter 9, if you want to look it up, he speaks about the mind and the heart. So just like physically, the mind and heart need each other. You know, the mind is the central nervous system, and it controls the nerves, and it controls even how the heart functions. God forbid if there's some severing between the nerves of the mind that the heart can stop functioning. And also the other way around, the brain needs the blood. It's nourished by blood, and the blood originates in the heart. And the heart pumps blood to the mind, to the brain. So he says this, just like the heart pumps blood to the brain, the emotions also pump their feelings into the mind and distort the mind. So one thing would be if your emotions told you one thing, your mind told you another, and they're two separate worlds, and then you have two voices, and you have to make a decision. It would be far easier. The problem is the emotions are informing the mind. They actually change the mind's way of thinking. And you minimize and you justify, which is why any healthy, objective lawyer, judge and honest person is going to recuse himself or herself if he or she has self-interest in a case. And that's called being transparent. You know, you say, "This is, I have an interest here. I have an interest in this business. It's my brother, it's my sister, it's my cousin," whatever it is. We all have our interests. Because interest, self-interest, and it doesn't matter how smart you are, you cannot divorce it. The heart will pump blood to the brain no matter what, and so will emotions affect your mind. And even Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses, no godlier man than Moses, recused himself when having to say anything about his brother Aaron, because at the end of the day, it's his brother. This isn't a bad thing. It's the way the way of all flesh, the way the human being functions. So emotions have a very strong power. And that's why, for example, when a person is overwhelmed in pain or sadness, God forbid you go, no one should know of this, but you go to a shiva call, you can't start speaking rational explanations for a tragedy. Even if you find some explanation, I'm not saying there is one. A mind doesn't speak, a brilliant mind cannot speak to a bleeding heart. It's two different languages. And it's a critical component, by the way, in communication. Because many of us may be convinced of something, and you may be right. And rationally, on paper, you're absolutely right. But if that person can't hear it, it's because their emotions can't hear it. That means you're not that means you're not so smart as you think you are. Smartness is knowing how to communicate to somebody, not just being right. And if you can't communicate it, then you're not dealing with another reality. The reality of existence is that we are subjective creatures and affected by our emotions. So therefore, it becomes increasingly difficult to implement many things, because we may understand it, we may understand joy, and we understand, and yet to implement is another story. You know, you can understand something, and then something happens to you that affects you emotionally, and all your intelligence goes out the window for that moment at least. So the real challenge is not just to understand the nature, the philosophy of the idea, but it's also the psychology, which is why in Judaism, philosophy and psychology are not two courses. They're not two. They're not two subjects. They're actually one. But it's two steps in a process. You know, to use an expression, a borrowing expression from some psychological models, there's a thing called a cognitive life raft. You know, like a life raft. When you're drowning or you're stuck at sea, lost at sea, so someone sends you a life raft. A life raft is what allows you to float till you find some safety, to safety. And psychologically speaking, we also have certain life rafts. When a person is in a panic state or anxiety or is not seeing clearly, there's the thing called a cognitive life raft that some psychologists call. It's basically being able to envision with your mind the basis of some of cognitive therapy. But with your mind, envisioning something, so though emotionally you may not be there, emotionally you're still in an anxious state of mind or something like that, but at least in your mind you envision with your imagination a situation, and it becomes a life raft, because you can at least in your imagination go to a safer place. And then of course the goal is, how do you translate the cognitive process, life raft, into an emotional security? But it's a first step often to help people, it's one method of many, to help people go from a place of complete emotional overwhelming, at least trying to envision a situation that is a little safer. And if someone that's trained and someone who knows how to do it, you can guide you to come to a place of that. There's a cognitive life raft. Children do it often, without even being trained, simply to survive. In a very traumatic situation, what a child will do, and we adults will also do, will detach themselves from the experience and almost go into their own mind. It's like escaping into your mind. It's a cognitive life raft that helps you survive until you get to a point where you can work on the rest of the situation. So in Jewish thinking, in Jewish Torah, there's the first thing is understanding the nature, it's called the anatomy of joy, and the anatomy of the human being, spiritual anatomy of the human psyche. And the second step is interventions, what you can do about it. So obviously the second follows the first, which you want to understand it, and then you want to figure out methods. So being that I've discussed the understanding of it in the past, I wanted to focus more on the methods. But I want to just sum up some of the so-called philosophy before we get to the psychology. So different words, the idea, the concept, before we get to the application. So the concept goes like this. That by virtue of your soul, which is the life force with which you were born, before you had any life experiences, every human soul is by nature joyful. A soul is a joyous entity. And let me define what joy means, or happiness in this context. Happiness and joy in this context is not the one we confuse with. When you go to a party, and someone says, well, you know, at a party you're dancing and singing, people say, well, that means you're happy. That is a state of, that's what we call a verb, an action, maybe a happy action, but it doesn't make you a happy person. You could be a miserable person and also act very happy, and you can drink and get yourself high and dance and celebrate as if you were happy, but the truth is you're suffering inside. As the line they say, some dance to remember and some dance to forget. So dancing and joy in this world that we live in is actually often a numbing force, not actually a force of awareness. It's a way of hiding your misery and anxiety. What is the Torah's definition of simcha? You know, being that it's Hebrew, it's always harder to translate. So we use words like joy, happy. So I want to go away from those words and just define it much more of a, I guess, in a more esoteric way. Joy and happiness is equivalent to seamlessness. When you know that you are right now in the right place, in the right time, and you belong, that is the nature of true happiness. So it's not some type of commodity or object that you get. It's a state of being. It's a state of being of sensing total belonging. And the opposite of a beat, when you feel you don't belong, you feel that out of sorts, you feel detached, disconnected, that is a state of sadness. Now I know that's not the definition most of us would suggest, but this is the definition to understand it fully in the Torah spiritual map, so to speak. So it comes down to this, that the soul is a state of connection. I mean, you can call it divine connection, but a connection to its purpose. So think of it, let's just use, you want to talk about cognitive life raft, here's a cognitive exercise. Imagine, if you could, that for one day at least, if you could imagine your entire life this way, that would be even greater. But imagine that every second of your life, every second of your day, you know that where you are and what you're doing is exactly why you were sent to this earth to do it. You know, it's as if God comes and tells you it's exactly what you're doing, it's exactly what you should be doing right now. You're fulfilling your life's purpose. You're fulfilling the reason that your soul came down to this earth. I mean, for most of us, that's such a fantasy. You know, say, who can ever tell us such a thing? Well, that's what I'm saying. Use the imagination. Just a purely imaginary thing. You think it's a fantasy, so be it. You know, we've had worse fantasies than this, I'm sure. You know, it's a positive fantasy, imagination. That exactly, that whatever it is you're doing, you're fulfilling fully your potential and purpose of being. What would it do to your spirit? I mean, it goes without saying. You would have nothing to worry about, because this is exactly what you should be doing now. You don't have to worry about someone else taking away your piece of turf. You don't have to be worried about, are you doing the right thing? There's no question about it. You're doing exactly what it is. And I'm not even talking about what that thing is. It's just a state of being. That is a state of pure joy. So a soul without a body, without entering this existence, doesn't have any other choice. You see, it's only in this world where we get disconnected from purpose, where form and function become two worlds, where there's a duality. Is there such a thing as a sad newborn if it's not impacted by medications or drugs that the mother, God forbid, may have taken? No, a child that's just born sad. A child just cries all the time. Unless there's an illness, and there are illnesses, of course, God forbid, every child is born naturally happy. Will smile. Again, unless there's something stopping it. But the natural, and it makes no difference what kind of parents that child had. Again, unless the parent did something, which I don't even want to mention, unspeakable things that can actually affect the child's physiology, a child will be born happy. Remember, even the most dysfunctional mother cannot intrude inside her womb when the child is being carried unless she ingests something. So a child is protected even from its mother, even the worst possible mother. As long as that child is being carried inside, it's God that's protecting the child, because there's the embryonic fluids and the embryo completely protected from the elements and so on. As a matter of fact, a pregnant mother can even eat very unhealthy foods and it won't necessarily cause great damage to the child. Again, I'm not talking about severe or extreme situations. I'm not suggesting that, you know, pregnant women should definitely be careful, the more the better. But there's a lot of protection, a lot of filtering going on. So that child inside the womb for 9 months developing is emerging very well protected from all the elements and the toxins of this world. Again, I'm not talking about exceptions, generally speaking. And that includes also the spiritual toxins, which means that child has a sense of belonging. There's no duality in that child's life. Now, no studies have ever been made, at least to my knowledge, of when a child first begins to develop a state of sadness, a state of depression, a state of... Again, I'm not talking about clinical or medical, I'm talking here now just the natural flow, ebb and flow of life. The reason there's no studies made, because no one knows the point, because no one can have a conversation with a child when that child goes over and becomes one of us. Let's put it that way. Whenever that age happens. But one thing is clear, the child doesn't learn it from inside, it learns it from outside. Because if a child remains in its childlike state, it will always remain having a cheerful attitude. This doesn't mean a child doesn't cry, and doesn't mean a child does not have pain, and doesn't mean a child can't be sad. We're talking about the natural equilibrium state of the child. now the child is deprived of something or wants something and so on. So where does a child learn the idea of being miserable? From miserable adults. That's where the child learns it. There's nowhere else to learn it from. It's not like suddenly at age 6, the miserable gene suddenly awakens inside of us, because there is no such gene. So you start seeing people around you are not happy. And a child can see this very early age. Sees its mother and father are not happy with their lives. They're lost, they're confused, they argue. Whatever it is that they experience, the child suddenly sees a different type of, you know, how people behave. And that behavior affects the child. So when you don't get what you want, what does the child do? It looks at its parents and say, what do you do when you don't get what you want? You have a tantrum. Okay, that's what I do. Now, I know some will argue, one second, children have tantrums even without parents having tantrums. Yeah, because a child doesn't see a tantrum, but it sees this is how you react. This is how you demand, and so on. Now, this just to qualify, this doesn't mean that a child, even in the healthiest environment, is not going to have challenges, will not be emotionally overwhelmed. And a child, someone comes home from school and was hurt, or in some way was insulted, a child will cry. But that doesn't mean the child suddenly has become an unhappy child. It means that the child has been affected by something that's negative. What will determine the child's state of balance will be how it sees you cope with challenges. So from a Torah perspective, happiness is the domain of the soul, which means it's our God-given birthright, every one of us. What happens is, like with everything in life, that purity, that innocence, the enchantment, the sense of free abandon, slowly begins to go undercover as we turn into adults. Because we're told, or we see by example, that now you have to start controlling yourself. So of course there's certain elements of positive elements to maturity. I can't say everything about maturity is negative, but not everything is positive either. And the fact is that we lose our sparkle, and we lose that type of, that everything is possible as we get older, just like our arteries harden. I don't want to depress anybody here. And just like we discover that first wrinkle, or other things that are signs of, getting a little older, aging, so too psychologically. We don't have that type of, as I said, free abandon, that type of, effervescence that a child has. And often the way we dismiss it is by saying, well, the child's naive, hasn't yet seen real life. Let them see real life. They also won't be so effervescent. But that's not necessarily true. The opposite of naivete is experience and learning about life. That doesn't mean you become less happy person just because you learn about life. There are people you meet that are extremely happy people even though they've suffered greatly in their lives. Which of course begs another question. Why is it that some people have that and some don't? So basically the answer to all this is that it's not genetic. That it's part of it. Well, let's put it this way. It's genetic. Everybody is happy. We're all born happy creatures. After that is where it goes downhill. And the question is, how do you reconnect to that natural state? That's the real question. So I've been discussing the last few weeks, and it's a common theme, I guess, lately, at least in this class, that there's really two ways to look. There are two types of experiences that we have in life. And it's a very good study in contrast. You know, we live in a world that is very acquisitions-oriented, commodity-oriented. You want something, you have to go get it. You have to be a go-getter, aggressive, and go find it and buy it or however way you can get it. Exchange, trade, finagle, manipulate, barter, whatever it is. Give and take. That's the negotiations of life. So you want a loaf of bread, you go to a bakery. You want to find a job, you have to go to the classifieds, advertise yourself. Everything is you go out and get it. It's a commodity that you don't have right now and you have to go and get it. And don't underestimate how much this affects our psyche. Is this actually the best way to get things? So it sounds like almost a foolish question. Well, how else am I going to get a loaf of bread if I don't go out and get it? It's not going to just imagine it. Even if you follow the rules of The Secret, the book, and the laws of attraction, nobody thinks you imagine a loaf of bread and suddenly a loaf of bread emerges on your desk on your table. So what other way is there to go? But that's not my point. My point, of course, obviously, you want to get something you don't have in your house, you have to go out and get it. The thing is this what defines how we get things? That's really the question here. Because when you look at by contrast now, a whole other series of, I won't call them commodities, a whole other series of realities that we want in our lives, and that whole rule of going out and getting it doesn't apply. So let's just make a list of them. Love, truth, soulfulness, happiness, and joy, which we shall discuss. Where do you get it? What shop? What store? So of course there's best-selling books that promise it, different promises how to find joy and happiness and love and so on. But there's something to be said why they still remain bestsellers, right? And one doesn't work, and then there's another one that becomes a bestseller because it's an elusive journey, you know. So even though someone once said to me, one second, maybe those books worked, and now that everyone else who's miserable is getting the next book. Halavai, maybe that's the case. I don't know if that's exactly accurate. So it's like the guy that goes into the self-help store, self-help section, he goes into a bookstore and asks, where's the self-help section? So the manager says, but if I told you, that would defeat its purpose, you know. So the point is that these realities, as I said, truth, love, and ideas for that matter, cannot be purchased. Yeah, you can buy yourself a good education. You're not buying ideas, you're buying the access, you're buying the way it's delivered to you. So how do we then access these truths? There's only one way. You can't go and get it, you have to allow it to emerge. So it's a whole different way of achieving it. It's actually exactly opposite. So here we go. You have five senses. Each of us have five senses. Right? Correct me if I'm wrong. We see things, we hear things, we smell, sound, touch. Right? Well, I'm sorry, I said sound and hear. No. Sight, sound, taste, touch, and smell. Five senses. That is the only way we can experience and interact with the world around us. No other way. If you were to shut off your senses, all of them, what would you be left with? So initially, the thought may be, the prospect may be daunting, you know, overwhelming. You'd think you'd just disappear. But you wouldn't disappear. You'd be left with your thoughts and your feelings. You'd be left with whatever it is that you experience internally. You know? You ever hear yourself, like, listen to yourself on a tape, you know, recorded audio? Anybody like their voice on audio? You know? Because what you hear is not like what you hear all the time, because you hear yourself from here. And people hear you that way. And when you hear it, you say, like, you know, I can tell you, sometimes I listen, I say, I don't know why anyone would listen to this guy. And I have plenty of recordings, you can imagine. But that's life. It's just I have to ignore that, some things. So if our senses were shut down, we suspended them for a while, you'd be left with an inner life. And actually, we don't have many tools how to function with that inner life. You know why? Because the senses are continuously affecting us. Our senses are not just alive, they're overstimulated in the world in which we live. You're always seeing things and hearing things and smelling things and touching things and tasting things. All the time. And that is our modus operandi in how we function in this world. It's our fallback position. So it's not so simple to suddenly experience super sensory experiences when you're so addicted to your senses. And I'm not suggesting senses are not a blessing. But they are, what they are is tools to interact with things outside of you, not within yourself. That's why nobody needs eyes to see themselves, or ears to hear yourself, or taste, touch, and smell to experience yourself. But we do live in a world for us to interact, and even two people who love each other, you know, there is something to be said about seeing two lovers see each other. They touch each other, they hug each other. So I'm not suggesting the senses can be used for internal, inner and intimate experiences, but on their own, they are outer tools. And their seductive power is so intense that they block out our ability to really process with a different thing we'll call supersensory tools. Senses can only experience life, like I said, outside in. Commodities that we we acquire. Supersensory tools function the exact opposite way. They shut everything off, and something emerges. It would be like pushing everything away, and then something emerges. Actually, even in the cognitive process, in the mind, the way the mind works. So I don't know if you've ever thought about this. You know, the two ways really the mind can process an idea. One way is you hear an idea, a new idea, you read it or you hear it, and then you begin to think about it, and you start connecting it to other ideas that you've had. And Maven Dover, Meteich Dover, for example, the expression, you understand one thing leads to another. And it becomes suddenly fits into the picture that you had, but now the picture is more complete. You know, you had a certain picture till today. Now you heard a new idea. This idea has helped fill in a certain element. You know, there could be many ideas. And this is a process all of life for acquiring knowledge. That's one way. There's another way, which is far more complicated, but actually far more profound. And that is where you shut off all your processing tools and almost forget everything that you've ever learned. And hearing something completely new, as if you never heard it before, and allowing a new truth to emerge as opposed to fitting into a truth that you had before. Now, both are legitimate approaches, but the first one is always going to fit into an existing framework. It's not going out of your comfort zone. And as a matter of fact, the smarter you are, the more that new idea you're going to make sure it fits into somewhere that it fits. It's very difficult for an adult, a thinking adult who's developed ideas, to suddenly take an idea and suddenly say, you know what, everything I knew till now is meaningless. I'm going to start from scratch. Very, very difficult to do. Because it's your strength. Why would you reject? Why would you discard and divest yourself of ideas that you've had till now? But the Talmud tells the story of Rab Zera, who fasted, some say, he fasted 40 days, 40 fasts rather, or 100 fasts, to forget the Babylonian Talmud in order to learn and study the Jerusalem Talmud, which is a little strange, or maybe very strange. You know, why would you need to forget knowledge to acquire knowledge? Knowledge is accumulative. Since when? You have to forget 2 plus 2 is 4 to learn that 4 plus 4 is 8? On the contrary. You know, 1, 2, 3, 4, that leads you to 5, 6, 7, 8, etc., etc. So small ideas lead you to bigger ideas. Since when does a small idea contradict getting to a bigger idea? And then additionally, Rav Zera, there's a law, a law in the Torah, halacha, that one is not supposed to deliberately forget Torah, God's wisdom. We forget, because we're forgetful, the natural state of the mind is one thing, but to deliberately go ahead and try to forget? So what is the Talmud telling us? Why did he fast? Which of course is another thing. What does fasting have to do with suddenly fasting? Well, Rav Zera was not interested in forgetting knowledge. He was interested in forgetting a methodology. The Babylonian methodology, as opposed to the Jerusalem, are two different ways the mind works. These were two academies. One was based in Jerusalem, one was based in Babylon. Basically, at the end of the destruction of the temple, Second Temple, and they though they're obviously one Torah, but their approaches to analyzing, to analysis, and to coming to conclusions are very different. One, in using a little Kabbalistic Hasidic language, one is called Er Yashar. It's coming to something directly. It's called like direct light, hearing an idea, and cutting to the and piercing it to its depths. And another is called Er Chayzer, which means refractive light. Think of it like the difference between the sun and the moon. The sun radiates, the moon reflects. And the same thing in the mind. The Babylonian approach is very much with arguments, argument, counter-argument, questions. B'machshakim ha'yishivani, the Talmud says. In darkness I sat. This is called Talmud Bavli. It's coming from darkness to light. So the Jerusalem Talmud is light shining into you like an idea that illuminates. And the Babylonian is first confusion. First, Bavel, the word Babylonian, Bavel, Talmud Bavli, means confusion, confused languages. And from confusion you come to clarity. And it's interesting that the Babylonian Talmud comes to deeper conclusions than the Jerusalem one, because it goes through the questions. When you stretch an idea and you challenge it in every possible direction, you'll always get more crystallized conclusion. Whereas a smart person may come up with a great idea, but if it's not challenged, it won't be as thorough, and won't have covered all the bases. So that's what Rav Zeir wanted to do. He wouldn't want to forget the knowledge, he wanted to forget the methodology. And the achievement, the monumental achievement of such a thing is impossible to describe. How many people do you know? Most of us, they say by the time you're 18 months, you already have developed all the ways you're going to be thinking. 8 years old, 9 years old. Here a man, I don't know what his age was, 40, 50, 60, should go and deliberately look to find a new methodology simply in his passion to uncover new methods of understanding. So to take this back to our discussion here, so there's really two types of experiences. One we're very accustomed to, because it's very easy, it's the material world in which we live, the commodity-oriented one, you go out and acquire things. And the other is the one that emerges, and that's much much more complicated in an acquisition level, an acquisition-oriented society. Now, interestingly, children don't know about the acquisition part. That's why they don't invest in stocks, and that's why they don't go out and shop. Not because they can't walk yet and they don't understand that the great things, great, as they say, Grace Glicken, great delights inside these stores, is because children are living internally. A child is excited just by looking in a room and crawling around and seeing what the floor looks like. We don't get excited by things like that. You know, a child is emerging and experiences emerging realities, not acquired ones, until it's trained and it's basically corrupted to begin thinking the other way. Now, I'm not suggesting one has to remain purely that. We want to be able to be in a sensory world, but not compromise your supersensory experiences. And children naturally have that joy because joy is the domain of the inner, never of the outer. So if someone says, you know what, give me your wish, I would say, give me your wish list, tell me here, list everything that if you were able to get tomorrow delivered to you, will make you a happy human being. Do you think that will ever be fulfilled? So we all, across the board, I've tested this with many people. People, absolutely. Give me that list, I will definitely be a happy person. Yeah, you'll be happy for that day. That I probably correct, especially when the delivery comes, which we're all happy, you know, when packages are still, like, closed. But as, who is it that said? Mr. Spock of Star Trek said, it's always more pleasurable to want than to have, you know? So let's not forget the power of wanting something and not having it. Now, everyone should be blessed to have everything they want. But, you know, the real domain of pleasure is, I remember, I think it was my daughter that told it to me once. She said that she learned it in school. You know, children get excited about certain things, and I would get excited because she got excited. And then I thought about it, and what was the line that, when you don't have what you want, it's time to start wanting what you have. That was the line she told me when she was maybe 4 years old. And I thought about it, yeah, pretty good, I like that. And of course, we move on and we go back to wanting what we don't have, that type of thing. But the point is that in really defining joy and defining what makes a person tick, these are two different approaches that are, in our case, as adults stuck in battle. Mostly, we live in a acquisition society, and therefore, we definitely think that if I get something, it will satisfy me and make me happy. Now, I would define that happiness as being a verb at best, meaning, yes, at that moment you may be happy, but that does not make you a happy person. It gives you something to be happy about for a moment. I would even submit that if you're not a happy person, even that's not happening. It's just complete sugar-coated. It's like anything. You can drink a dose of caffeine, and I'm sure there are also pills you could take that make you feel good for a while. That didn't change anything. It just covers it up. Now, it may be necessary to so-called blunt anxiety and stuff like that. So I'm not suggesting that sometimes we may need that. But happiness is something that is a wellspring from within the soul. And children have it naturally because they have not yet been jaded and toxified and corrupted by the world around us. And for us, it's a very elusive journey. And love is the same thing. And the same thing is truth. They're all in the same domain. They all come from the emerging state of realities. Abraham discovered it when he started looking for God. So he looked everywhere. That's what you do, right? A smart person starts looking. Where do you start looking? You look in the heavens. You looked at the sun, the moon, the meadows. And he couldn't find God. And the more he looked, the more he realized it's all part of the same reality. The sun is just millions of miles away, that's all. But still part of my existence. The stars and so on. And then he came to the big realization. The realization was that truths emerge. They can't be found. And he realized, let me shut down all my search, all my brilliance, and just let's see what happens. And that's what he did. Through humility, through not searching, he found the truth. And God emerges. And that's what God told Moses when he said, let me see your face. God says, no one can see my face and live. What does that mean? It means to experience true reality, you have to shut down your aggressive tools, and then things emerge. In love, there's no better way to express it. You want to really love another person, them to love you. Now, we're trained that there's all kinds of techniques for that. And things don't work, you try this and you try that. And you go to therapy and you communicate, right? You communicate, you share your issues. And then you try to hear what the other person has to say. Now, all that is very useful, but it's not the. But I guarantee that it can't completely work for this following reason. And I'll share one episode that I think captures it well. There's a couple who are going through what they call domestic situation. And I guess for quite a few number of years, they came to see me. Now, my first question, of course, was, what have you done till now? So they've gone to this therapy and that therapy, all different types of work. So obviously you're here, that means that it hasn't worked. But has anything worked? Has it gotten better? You know, I'm just trying to understand the lay of the land, as they say. You know what? How you got from here to here, from there to here. So they said there was one therapist that actually worked for a while, but it didn't last. So what did this therapist do? She had them both make lists. So it's called list therapy. That's my name for it. Lists. So the woman made a list of needs and then numbered them from 1 to 10, 1 being the most important, a vital, absolute, necessary, indispensable need, and 10 going down, more and more dispensable to the most optional. And the man did the same thing. The husband did the same thing. And then, in column 2, this gets complicated, so follow me along, hopefully. Column 2, so how much of this need is being fulfilled by your spouse? So like if it's number 1 in importance, and if it's number 10 being satisfied, obviously that's a bad situation. If it's number 1 and number 3 in satisfaction, then it's better. So they both had these two lists. One was importance of need and how much of it is being filled. And then, next list. Is what do you think each one didn't yet see the other person's list? In other words, their numbers rather. They saw the list, but not how it was numbered. Now, what do you think you're doing for the other person in that regard, that need? Is it 1 from 1 to 10? So now you can also see the discrepancy. You know, she says it's she's getting only 10 of something that she considers a 1, and he says I'm giving 2. You know, anyway, you get the picture here. So they had this big map of needs. And everyone is describing how important this need is. And what was illuminating to them was that first time, certain things they were completely surprised, they didn't even realize. They didn't realize it was so important to each other. You know, this was your need. I didn't know it was so important. I didn't know that you really feel I'm not doing that much. No, their intentions were good. They weren't looking to point fingers. It just wasn't working. So I said, so great, that sounds like great. So what happened? So they said, well, what happened was we had both these lists. She said, I had mine on the refrigerator, he had his on his desk, and we'd keep running to our list every time something happened. Oh, I forgot this is an important need. I said, it became like a minefield, and we started, you know, it was like we weren't living our lives. His lists were like controlling everything. So for a few months it lasted well, because the lists dominated the conversation, so there was no time to argue. But at some point, you know, you have to like become natural about it. And she started accusing him, you're not really doing it with a whole heart, you're only doing it because it says it on the list. You know, you could imagine. So they're back to square one. Okay, so just to keep things a little light and humorous, I said to them, okay, so here's my suggestion. I think we should make one more list. And they said, do me a favor, we threw out the lists, we burned those lists, you know. And I said, this list is a different type of list. This list is called the giving list, not the needs list. What do you give? Forget about anybody's needs here. What do you bring to this relationship? What do you offer? And what do you want to offer? And what are you capable of offering? Or at least what you think you're capable of offering. And, you know, initially they looked at me, they didn't really, but then they started thinking about it and realized that we live in a world, well, just to tell you, the end of the story is yes, they're very happily married today. I can't say what I did was the magic pill, but it was one thing that clicked and it changed the way they started thinking. And I'm sure cumulatively of all the work they've done and everything, it worked out. And I'm still in touch with them. They're a very fine couple. I send people to them, actually. Anyone has issues, I send them, because they went through everything, you know. And the they tell the list story and so on. What changed was, and I say it's one step in the process, was we are so trained to think in terms of, I have my needs. And now the question is, are you satisfying them or not? And if you are, then I'm ready to give you something. You know, like the guy says, I'm ready to give you unconditional love as long as I get my needs met. You know? So we live in a need and acquisition-oriented society, and we negotiate all the time. So even though no one likes to talk about romance and relationships and love in terms of business, but there's a certain subtle form of business negotiation going on, except it's not spoken about quite in that way. It's a give and take. And so I'll say, one second, if I don't get anything in this relationship, why should I give anything? Which sounds like a very fair question. But it's coming from a different set of rules. It's at that those rules are very fine when you write contracts and you're doing business. So you're doing business. You're not. It's not someone you have to have a lifetime deal with. There's an agreement. I'm putting up money. You give this in return. I give this. You give that. And we split to whatever it is until we come to some terms where everybody feels that they're being win-win. In a relationship like love and like joy, you're dealing with a whole different reality. You're trying to access a experience called love that doesn't come through acquiring things. When you love someone, you will give them things and you will also receive things. But it's not doesn't begin and end with needs. It begins and ends actually with giving. But you have to. So either you're a natural giver or we have been corrupted in this world not to give. And especially when we've been hurt. We say, why would I give? Give me a good reason to give. A true giving person never asks the question, give me a good reason to give. As soon as you make that statement, rest assured there's something going, something's wrong. You know? And newborn and young children never ask that question until they're told. I saw this with my own eyes. I remember my granddaughter, I took her once to school. I was visiting my daughter in California. I came to pick her up after lunch. And there were kids playing, so I was just standing there. And one kid asked another friend to give her a toy. And her mother, of all people, it surprised me. Her mother said to her quietly, she said, if she gives you something, you'll give her this. So I didn't pass any judgment. Of course, I didn't say anything. And I could say, maybe something happened. And then I asked the teacher. The teacher said, no, that's the way she is in her life. She knows her. So, and it seems so natural. Why not? Well, that makes sense. You know, it's a logical thing. You live in a tough world. Why would you give somebody something if they don't give you something? I agree, as in the business, that's how it is in business. Even halachically, in business, there are rules. There is a give and take. People have, there are incentives, there are profit, and there are other so-called people should deserve for what they've effort. But when it comes to the true commodities like love and God, you know, the classic story of Woody Allen's cynicism, where the guy comes to the rabbi. Rabbi, will you teach me I hear the Torah has the secrets of all life and the truth of life. He says, yes. Will you teach it to me? Of course. How much will it cost? How could I charge? God didn't charge for the Torah. Moses didn't charge for it. No one ever charged for it. So how could I charge? They sit down, they open up a Torah, it's all in Hebrew. So the rabbi says, Hebrew lessons will be $10,000. You know? So of course this is an excellent classic joke, fits into the stereotype of religious connivers and hucksters and so on. God, truth, Torah, love, joy, these are all free commodities. But they're actually more expensive to acquire than all the money and all the things that you buy in this world. You know why? Because you have to get beyond one thing. With money, you don't have to get beyond your own subjectivity and your own ego. You know, you want something, you have enough money, you can buy it. Comes to love and these things, you need to do something which is much harder, which is shed yourself. And that's a very difficult thing to do. Because we all are convinced that we may have some flaws, but we also have a lot of virtues. Why should I shed my virtues? You know, we're smart. If I'm smart, I want something. You know? But true love is experienced by people who do not ask the question, you know, why am I giving? It's a natural thing to give because a confident, secure person knows that they have endless amount to give. Can you imagine a true scholar, teacher, who has knowledge? So of course everybody maybe needs to pay their bills, but with withhold knowledge because they're not getting something in return, I would have big questions about a person like that. You know? True knowledge is giving. If it's a fair situation, people will understand, so you have to compensate, etc., because we live in a material world. But the element of natural giving is natural to the soul. It doesn't take any effort. For the rest of us, we have to reclaim and revisit that natural state of mind. So here there's five methods that I'd like to share with you of how a person can achieve that, reclaim the natural joy that's in your heart and soul. That's the key. It's reclaiming that which is there already. So I was thinking, I just didn't have the time, but I probably could work out some type of acronym. I only figured out the first three of the five has an acronym like GPS, which is good, you know, fitting, a compass to life. But there are five. And I'm going to go through them briefly. And I think that they are all, if you apply them, they are great exercises to cut away some of the outer layers that have perhaps changed our mentality, rewired us, to go back to that type of state where you could actually be naturally happy. Okay? And try it out and let me know how they worked. So the five, I'll just list them and I'll go through each one of them. I've already discussed most of them here, but I'll go through them specifically. One is give. Second is purpose. Soulfulness, commitment, and love. Okay, and they're not synonymous. They're five different things. So let's talk about that for a moment. Whether we like it or not, and I hope we like it, is this: that happy people are natural givers, and maybe better put, when you give, you're always happier than when you take. And it doesn't matter what you think about it, it's maybe counterintuitive, but it's like the guy that says in the Frisco Kid after he robs the train, and he steals everybody's jewelry and money, you know, takes everybody's stuff. So before he jumps off, he says, remember the rule and law of life, and that is, it's always better to give than to take. And then he proceeded to take everything they had. Okay, so I'm not suggesting that the guys in the train who were robbed are very happy about it, and that he was very sad about taking, but it's a way of thinking about what it is. The reason that taking doesn't provide happiness, even though for the moment it may, but it will provide what's called happiness as a verb, but not as a noun, not as a state of being, is because taking psychologically and subconsciously is sending the message to you that you need something from somebody, which means you're dependent and you're not complete without it. What is that? What sensation would you translate that into if you're able to go into your psyche ultimately? Yeah, for the moment, or for the while that you've acquired it, you feel happy, you feel fulfilled. Now I got what I wanted, but you needed it. We say in the benching, on the prayer after food, we say Loyli de matnas basar v'dam. We ask God that you should not sustain us through gifts of other people of flesh and blood. So though, unfortunately, there are people, obviously, that may need help, and we're obligated to give, and we can't say to them, hey, listen, go, you know, you have to, that's an obligation to help those that are needy. Obviously, the greatest help is to help people help themselves, but sometimes you have to put people on their feet, etc. But when we ask God, please give me without me having to depend on anyone else. So on a very basic level, it's a simple prayer, but if you think about it psychologically, if you had everything that you needed in your life, as I mentioned before, that cognitive imaginary exercise, that you are here, every second of your day is exactly what you should be doing, and you don't need anything or anyone for it, that is the happiest state of being. The fact that you need to take from someone else, and I'm talking about even however you get it, and I don't care even if it's respectful, the bottom line is somewhere deep inside means that there's a lack. And that's why the most secure people, the people with the most sense of self and self-esteem, are the people who are the easiest to coexist with, the people who are the easiest givers, the people who never feel missing something, because they always can rely on what they have. They don't feel like, if I don't have that, I'm lacking. So, giving therefore is always a root of happiness. Try it out. As counterintuitive as it may be, you know, most people will say, and I've tried, you know, I've spoken to people, some people say to me, listen, when I'll be happy, that's when I'll start giving. I say, then we start giving, you'll be happy. So we get into this, you know, this merry-go-round where we go nowhere. So they, basically their argument is like this. You know, I feel bad about myself. I feel sad. Now you want me to be giving also? You know, type of thing. I have to now take care of myself. Which they don't understand. That itself is defeating the whole, there's the most self-defeating thing you can do. How do you build confidence in a person? By sitting and just wallowing in your own misery and saying, I'm going to take care of myself? The best way to build confidence is to show somebody that they can achieve something. And when you can't do it with yourself, you do it with someone else. Which is why when you call a mispal ba'at chavere hu nana tchila, the Talmud says, when you pray for someone else in need, you will be answered first. Because when you go out and reach to somebody, that brings blessings. And psychologically speaking, sometimes it's hard to get over your own hump, your own blocks and impediments. So when you go out and you help someone, even if you're not in the mood, that begins to generate the natural joy inside the soul that's doing what it should be doing, and actually opens up a channel to happiness. So it's precisely because we're not in the mood of it, is what we should be doing. Like I said, shedding yourself. A person who's not in a happy state of being, mind, the last thing they want to do is be giving. But it's the first thing they should be doing. Because the key thing is to go against what you think is the right thing you should be doing, especially when you're, if everything is going well, then by all means, if it's not broken, no need to fix it. But if your life is not going the way it is, maybe you should try something different that you didn't expect to do, which is do the opposite of what you want to do, which is not turn inward, turn outward. And do something that's giving, volunteer, help somebody. Try it out, you tell me. Now the difficult part is that when a person is really depressed or in a really dark place, you can't even get them out of their basement, metaphorically speaking, to go do anything. Okay, that's another story. I don't really know what to do when someone just simply won't answer the door and won't answer telephones and stuff like that. But all we can do is try to help each other by suggesting that to stay in that type of isolated place is not necessarily, I would say not only necessarily, that feeds all problems. So the first method is to give. On Purim, the mitzvah is simcha, joy. But interestingly, Purim is also very bound, as everyone knows, to two major giving elements. Mishloach manos ish l'reyu, the giving of gifts. And matanos levyanim, giving to the poor. So you think, okay, what's the connection to simcha? You know, you can just say it's a whole list of Purim mitzvahs. One is some charity, one is giving food gifts, another is dancing and celebrating and drinking, or whatever it is that people do on Purim, feast. And then, so you know, but it's not the same case. It happens to be directly connected. The reason that these were designated, these became the traditions that Esther and Mordechai established at the end of Purim, was because they're connected, because giving brings joy. Giving creates unity. And unity and joy are very much one. And that's about reconnecting to others. In addition to the fact that when you do give and you do help somebody, just the fact itself is it's a happy occasion. You see someone else being a little happier. You think that doesn't affect you? It'll definitely affect. So that's one, give. Okay. The next is purpose. The Talmud says, which means everything God does is for the good. Latav is for good. And there are different stories the Talmud tells about things, situations that seemed not positive, and they ended up being good. Now, this does not mean that every experience in life is a happy experience. As this brings me back to the question I asked earlier. There are people who are fundamentally happy human beings, and yet, do they ever become sad? What happens when they suffer a loss? What happens if they went through the Holocaust? There were very happy people that entered the Holocaust. Did everybody that came out of it become miserable? No, absolutely not. Because there's two things. What happens in a human being's life is, as I think I mentioned last week and other times, you can suffer but not become a sufferer. Remember, I was talking about a verb and a noun. There's a state of being and there's an experience. In a commodity-oriented, acquisition-oriented universe, things are defined by actions, not by states of being. Love is a technique. It's a method. It's a thing you do. It's not a thing you are. Some say that that for women, love is a noun. For men, it's a verb. In truth is, truth, love, and all the other things I'm describing, joy, are all states of being. Even though they have their active way of working, but they are fundamentally states of being. A person who's a happy person does not mean they don't suffer, have never suffered. It's that the suffering does not define them. Because they are connected to that soul, and they see purpose in their lives. You know, Viktor Frankl, secular Jew and psychologist, who observed this, developed this whole theory of logotherapy, man in search of meaning, based on his experiences and what he witnessed in the concentration camps. And he made it very clear, and it became a whole theory, that the people with meaning were able to survive it all. And that doesn't mean they suffered less. It doesn't mean they were in more lenient circumstances. Absolutely not. It's because there's something inside of them that's more powerful than the suffering. So though the suffering happens, it doesn't completely destroy their lives. It's like the tree that remains standing even after the hurricane. So a hurricane happened. That tree went through a hurricane just like every other tree. But it had roots that allowed it to remain standing afterwards. Those roots are called the soul. And that soul is what gives purpose. So though we cannot always explain, and we'll never understand the Holocaust, how you can say, is it for the good? I wouldn't say it's for the good, but that makes no difference. That person still remains a good person, and did not allow the circumstances to turn them evil. So just because evil people did things to them, it didn't turn them into evil human beings, which would have made the evil people win. You're not going to win over my soul. You could kill, you can destroy, annihilate, but you will not destroy my goodness. Now that wasn't a conscious statement, it was one coming from that state of being. And there's no question, if a person doesn't have that type of connection, it becomes very difficult when something negative happens. So negative things in life are part of the reality of our material universe. That's not the issue here. The question is how you're going to ride through it. And that's where purpose comes into place. When you enter before the storm and realize that life has purpose, and you have a purpose, and you may not know the purpose of everything, but you surrender to the idea that there's a hidden choreography to life, then nothing can really destroy you. Which is why Jews are here today, by the way. How do we make it through 210 years of a Holocaust in Egypt, and only to be followed by all the other tragedies? And you can go through the whole list. Every empire had its day with the Jews. Whether it was the Egyptians, the Assyrians, the Babylonians, the Romans, the Greeks, the Greco-Syrians. I mean, I'm not going in any particular order. Later, the Spanish, the Inquisitions, the pogroms, the Cossacks, the Crusades. And finally, the Holocaust in our own time. How do they make it through that? It's almost like impossible, simply on a very mathematical level, the odds. Is because all this could not destroy something that was undestroyable, which was their spirit, that always remained alive. The Roman Empire, you read the books, The Rise and Fall of the Roman Empire, the classic. And the rise and fall of all empires, they all come down to one or two things, arrogance and narcissism. And then throw in a earthquake or two, and you basically have the destruction of the empire. But they were vulnerable, the infighting and so on. Now, Jews have fought plenty. We have plenty of infighting. But there's a soul that dominates beyond everything else. And this doesn't mean every individual Jew in the world is aware of that soul, but collectively it's there, and it would survive it all. So it was the sense of purpose. Abraham was made a promise, you will go to the promised land. Your children will flourish. And that promise was what they held on to. We'll say it's Passover. It's coming in around a month and a half. Yeah, time flies. We say v'hi sha'am d'lanu, v'hi, she, v'hi is a stated in the abstract, v'hi, she withstood everything as they tried to destroy us in each generation. What is this v'hi in the feminine? So it's either known, seen as the amuna, faith, and or the promise. So that is the context of purpose. I think Thomas Cahill, in his best-selling book, The Gifts of the Jews, he was a non-Jewish writer who writes how the Jews basically created civilization. And he says, I think he chooses 30 words that the Jews introduced into our lexicon, not our lexicon, into our lives. And one of them is that life has purpose. Now today that seems like such a lot of people know that. But it wasn't always seen that way. And that there's what we call divine providence. That there's a plan. That doesn't mean we know the plan. As a matter of fact, a smart person understands that when you're one little piece of 7 billion people, and then add all the generations, which makes it billions and billions, that to understand that plan would be quite an arrogant statement that I could get the whole picture when you're just one little piece of the picture in one corner of the earth, in one part of all of time. But that there is a plan is absolute certainty. That purpose is a very powerful tool in joy, because you always say to yourself, deep in your heart, that may not work out right now, but the big picture is going to work out. Someone just sent me an email. They suffered a great tragedy. Lost a young husband, a young woman lost her young husband. And at the end of the email, she signs off. She says, in the end, it will all be good. And if it's not good, it means it's not the end. Now, it would be a nice cliche coming from anybody, but this, I know what happened to her. So I understood this was not just written as a nice bumper sticker. But it was interesting, her expression. In the end, it will all be good. And if it's not the end, it means it's not. I mean, if it's not good, it means it's not the end. Does this mean that suffering is alleviated or that we don't have sadness and we don't cry? No. Happy people cry too. That would be ridiculous or unrealistic. A happy person cries, but tears don't shape and define the person. It's part of life's experiences. So however we want to understand it, one thing is for sure, that the Jewish people through the generations, they knew that if it won't be fulfilled in our time, it will be the next. And if it won't be me, it will be my children. There's no doubt that that spirit could not be vanquished, even in the gas chambers. And the proof is in the pudding. So the second thing is purpose. The third thing, soulfulness. Now, I know I mentioned soul several times, obviously, but specifically in soulfulness. That we all have a soul is a given. That soul has natural joy is also a given. But for you to access it, you have to live soulfully. And again, even if you don't understand how all these exercises can work, think of them like aspirins, or think of them exercises that trigger things. You act soulfully, and then your soul begins to speak back to you. Excuse me, that's how it works. No different than when you exercise your muscle does what it has to do. It's a give and take. What does soulfulness mean? So besides giving and having a sense of purpose that I've described, there's other soulful things you can do. The opposite of soulfulness is materialnessness. I don't know if there's a word like that, whatever. Soulfulness? No? Okay. We just coined one. Fine. We'll submit it to the wordsmiths. But whatever, the idea you get, being focused on matter as opposed to spirit. So soulfulness includes sensitivity. No, it's not such a popular word these days. Sensitivity means that you're sitting near a stranger in a subway or another situation. You're sensitive to that person. New Yorkers can be sensitive, right? Despite what the other parts of the world think. So sensitivity is a soulful way of experiencing things. When you wake up in the morning and you say Modani and you acknowledge your soul, when you look for soul everywhere you go, the soul in other people, the spark and potential in any situation, all that is a soulful experience. When you do that, there's a certain joy in that. Now, it's distinguishable from giving, because giving is a particular thing to give. I'm talking now about discovering soulful things in every situation. One of the reasons when we listen to music, which can be somewhat of a panacea or some type of instant gratification, but it definitely creates a certain sense of, tranquility or bliss inside of a person. But music is soulful. It's soulful. It has harmony. And it touches the harmony within us. And though we may not understand the science of music, but there's something about music that's very natural to our souls. I've discussed this at length as well here, how music is the language of the soul. So there are many things that are soulful that we can be doing. And it's, in a way, it is making your life musical. You know, I'm not suggesting you see someone that's in a bad mood, you start singing to them. Maybe that wouldn't hurt, but you need to have a little guts for that. And I've done that a few times. At first they look at you like a little crazy, and then hopefully it does has some impact. But there's many ways to sing to people. It doesn't always have to be with a song. There's a gentleness. There's a subtlety. There's a way to behave to people with respect. People know when you treat them with dignity. And soulfulness is another, dignity is another tool of soulfulness. And the list goes on. I'm sure you can find many examples. And if you deliberately act that way, guaranteed that another channel of joy flowing from your soul will enter your conscious life. Remember, we're talking about a wellspring that's inside there, but probably trapped. And probably very trapped based on all kinds of circumstances. So I'm talking about methods. How do you excavate it? How do you draw from it? So far I said giving, looking at things with purpose, and now was the third was soulfulness. And the last two, and if you need a shortcut, is GPS, just for the record. So you don't have to listen for an hour on the class to find out what these first three are. And then come the other two, which is CL. We'll figure out, maybe I can find some way to create some acronym, I'm not sure yet. Commitment, and the last one will be love. Commitment, okay. Commitment, I don't know if any of you have ever seen my book, I mean some of you I'm sure have seen the book Counting of the Omer, Spiritual Guide to Counting the Omer. So there are the seven emotions there. There's chesed, love, which is going to be the last thing I speak about. And there's gvura, and there's teferet, isn't it? But there's one called yesod, the sixth emotion. Yesod literally means foundation. But it also means commitment and bonding. So anybody here has what they call commitment issues? You know? You don't have to raise your hands here. But there are people who say they have commitment issues. Well, definitely their partners say they have commitment issues. That's usually more the way it's usually described. Now, commitment is something that, you know, somewhat, I would say, in our day and age, something that is not so often so common. Now, commitment means, is anything that you're still doing after 30 years? That would be a good sign of commitment. Commitment doesn't mean that while you're in a job and you're being paid for it, you're just committed to come to work every day, or that the commitment lasts for a while. Commitment means that even when it's optional, you still stick with it. And that is not so common in our lives. This class that we're sitting at right now here began in 1981, before some of you were born. I always like to say that. I feel seniority when I say that. And 1981, we're talking now 30 years, right? 31 years. And began completely with an unplanned. Two individuals came to see me looking for inspiration. I was a student at the time. I was writing the Rebbe's talks. I was in a completely different world, behind library walls and a whole different scholarship level. Scholarly level writing and all that, academics. And we began to talk. It was one Thursday night. Later it was changed to Wednesday night, just a few years. So this is Wednesday night, it's already 28 years. Maybe somebody will want to make write a biography about this class. And those two friends brought the next week another friend. And another friend brought another friend. And ever since, it's been friend bringing a friend, word of mouth. Never advertised it, never been announced in any way. It simply was. So every one of you are connected to, I would say, over 35,000 people that came from 30 years ago. Now, sometimes one person came, sometimes 10 people came, sometimes 20, sometimes 80, 100. There was no rules, you know. And I'm sure there were all kinds of things. There was weather issues, people have colds. I never stopped it. I never stopped it because I was trained by the best in my mind that when you start something good, you don't stop it. I had no clue. It was not like a plan. Start a class, and one day it'll be a meaningful life center. I didn't even dream of that name yet. Forget about writing. I was writing talks of the Rebbe in Yiddish, in the most dense scholarly type of talks. I didn't have any clue that I'd be where I am today. But I stuck with it. And I have to say I'm proud of that. And I stuck with it through thick and thin, because I saw around me, not many, but a few people that had strong impact on my life. And I saw that one of the things, they always stuck with things. Good things. They never stopped something. It made no difference. There was no such thing as a rain date. There was no such thing as, oh, we're under the weather and therefore we're not doing it. It didn't exist. And not because it was superhuman. It was commitment. Now, obviously, commitment to a good thing, not just blind commitment to whatever comes your way. And I can tell you that my life has changed as a result. So this, I'm a living specimen here. And I'm not the only one. So I say to you like this, you want joy in your life, find something and commit to it, and never stop. Whether it's once a week, whether it's once a day, whether it's once a month, but it's not about cramming it into one session, it's about consistency. It's like that example of Rabbi Akiva's story, the drops of water, accumulatively, slowly, slowly, persistently, they finally pierce through a stone. The power of consistency and persistence is impossible to describe. And we don't see it, because you can never see it in the moment. The whole power of it is over time. That's what commitment means. It's an overtime thing. It's a thing that can only be appreciated in a long time. I mean, so I would suggest that take something, choose something, commit to it, and guaranteed, money back guarantee, that you will find joy. That will bring you joy. Will it spill over and your whole life will change? That could also happen. But you'll always have that to look to, something that is consistent, and it will be always a source of inner gratification, and even outer. So that's number four. And finally, number five, love. Okay, that elusive love. You know, for some of us, finding joy is easier than finding love. But love, too, is a state of being and not an act. You know, you could have people who love you. You could have parents who love you, family, friends, a spouse, whatever, someone loves you. But there's two types of love, as I said earlier. One is you're receiving love, and another is that it becomes a noun, it becomes a state of being. Now, the interesting thing, as I said before, with giving, loving is more about loving someone than being loved. But we live in an insecure world where many of us were deprived of love, and therefore we're like desperate for someone to love us, for someone to nurture us, for someone to say, I care. And I'm not dismissing the importance of it. You know, it's like water. A flower needs water, and you don't have it, you wither. Every one of us is in need of that type of love, so we deserve it. The question is, how are you going to get it? So you can either become very smart and manipulative and wily to figure out ways for people to love you. And if you're really good, you cover your tracks so you don't look desperate, and you don't look like very needy, but you know, you get what you want. Everybody knows if they fit that bill. And or sometimes it's not so not obvious. It becomes very obvious. You know, hopefully it doesn't become pathetic. But either way, is that a life? That you're basically trying to figure out how to get something that you were deprived of. So there's another way. And that's taking some risk. It's a risky way. Not as safe as the way I just suggested. And that is to give love. Now, of course, the obvious question is, how could I give love to someone who I don't know if I could trust? And they may take advantage of me. And they may use me. So, first of all, if you're a smart person, there's ways to give love, and you can still protect yourself. Giving love does not mean that you suddenly open yourself up and anyone could just take advantage. Giving love means, like I said with giving, it means the ability to reach out to someone, even if you don't get something in return. The reason it's difficult is because we're not trained to think like that. As I said, we're trained to think in terms of tit for tat. And especially if we've been hurt, we're definitely protective. But there are creative ways to give, and even that may not be something you get in return. And you know something? And if you don't get in return, after a while, maybe this person is not your person, not for you. And you haven't lost much. So I'm not suggesting going on the limb and completely. You know, again, I'm talking a situation where a person is, let's say, dating or trying to find someone to love. Obviously, if you have someone that you love and there's problems, that's a whole different set of events. Like I spoke about the therapy, we have to, two people who love each other may not have the tools. They have to learn how to give to each other. But I'm talking about even in stages where we're still so-called exploring, one of the ways to counter the debilitating effects of lack of love and the hunger and the thirst around it is to give love. And it's, again, it's counterintuitive, but it's the tool that counters that type of, what I called earlier, the acquisition approach to things. You go get it, and with all the conditions of how you purchase and acquire and trade and that whole negotiation thing. So there you have the five steps, five ways rather, five methods. Give, purpose, soulfulness, commitment, and love. So as we enter now the month of Adar, a new month, and it says as the month, Mishanachnas Adar Marbim B'Simcha, as Adar enters, we increase in joy. And the interesting thing, it doesn't say when we enter, Mishanachnas Adar, when Adar enters. It's like the energy of the month enters into our lives, which if you think about it is like an emerging thing. It's not like you're entering into joy, it's that joy is entering into you. Marbim B'Simcha, that's when we should add, do things that are Simcha. So the Adar is, gives you the energy. And now we have to do things, and when you do things, you increase in doing certain things. That itself brings you joy. So the approach is, you know, don't wait to be happy to begin to do things that make you happy. Do things that make you happy, and then you begin to become happy. I don't know if that came out right, but if it didn't, fine, so be it. You get the idea. The idea is that basically, that it's not always your mood that it should never be your mood that defines what you do. You know. It's not always easy. You may have to overcome some stuff. Now, the sixth thing, which I didn't mention here, is what I always mention, is hanging around people that do these five things. That would be my sixth thing, because that always helps, finding examples, role models, mentors. And, of course, that means diminishing the people that don't do these five things also, meaning don't too much overexposure to people who don't do this is not going to be very helpful in this journey. So, maybe I'm subjective, but I think I see a little more smile on people's faces now than an hour and a half ago when we began. I hope it lasts. Maybe I'm being presumptuous, but you know, don't contradict me. I hope this is true. And the bottom line is that may everybody have not just a joyful month and week and day, but a life. And that hopefully new channels and reservoirs of Simcha can begin to flood your life, your consciousness. And it doesn't happen automatically. It's in there, but you have to access it. And when you begin to access it, you suddenly realize that it's really an emerging experience. And you realize that it's a resonating joy, not one that is coming from outside, but coming from within. And it's a far different one than what we do when we medicate or we do other things that we try to trigger a joyous experience. It's a whole different thing when it's generated from internally. So I wish everybody a very happy life. Not to say we're saying goodbye, you know, I'm sure I'll see you all, but maybe this class, this month, can be a catalyst that, as I said, triggers new opportunities. And may we all bring joy to each other. And may this month be a joyful one in every possible way. And even if we do have here and there once in a while a setback, remember, you're not defined by your setbacks. You're defined by who you are, not by what happens to you. And that is a simchadik, a joyous soul waiting to emerge. So I say again, the class is dedicated for Shlema, for Rivka Bat Leah. May she be well, speedily, in all revealed ways. And as always, an honor to speak to all you joyous souls. Now, hopefully your bodies also become joyous. Philip will be giving his class tomorrow night, so please contact us if anyone's interested at 7 p.m. at a different location. And next week we will have a class. Purim, we will not have a class live. It will be broadcast because of the space is being used for Megillah and so on. But we'll keep you posted in the emails, which reminds me, if anybody hasn't left your email address, please do so. Any other announcements? Any other announcements from our sponsors? Level? I'm sorry? So that you're already beginning early, 2 weeks ahead. There's some hamantash in here. That was not on my list of things that cause joy. But it'll definitely, for the few moments that the sugar will definitely make you forget. Our goal here is, as we said, to dance to remember, not to dance to forget. So with that being said, everyone have a, bid you all a beautiful evening and day and night and morning, wherever you may be in the world. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.